some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. Life have grown, I'll fly away like a bird from whose prison bars has flown.
Good morning. Oh, there's an answer or an echo. And welcome, kind of odd to say that, welcome to First United Methodist Church and our live stream of worship on this Sunday morning. And last week we were wondering if anybody would show up and if anybody would tune in. And even though we can't see it, we know that we are connected across our family and across the states of the United States, and most importantly, connected to the Lord our God. So welcome in whatever way you join us this morning. It's great to be connected, and we do solicit your feedback. If you're watching the stream, please let us know, real time or in the days ahead, how you've experienced it, how we might make it better, and how it's helped you to stay connected to your family. A few announcements for the good of the family. Don Streit is now at home, having returned home from Maple Crest Nursing Care and Rehabilitation. So we celebrate that he's at home, And we do ask that that no visits take place, but if you want to contact Don and Darlene, express your well wishes. By all means, keep them in your prayers. We lift up the Tillema family and ask that you'd continue to pray for them as they watch over Mary. We got a couple of changes to what you're going to experience if you're watching our live stream at home. One is that as you logged on, you might have seen a screen that included a couple of click options. One of them is for online giving, and so you can back out to that screen and click, or you can come back after the service is over and click. If you click on the online giving tile right now, we're set up to take transfers from your bank account. You're able to put in the routing information and make a donation. We believe that in the week ahead, that's going to become enabled for text giving and for credit card giving. There's another tile in that same place at that kind of main screen where you came in to watch the service. There's a place for a bulletin. If you'd like to have a bulletin to follow along with what's happening and see what's coming up next and maybe go for a snack when I start preaching, then you can click on that. And I say this hoping that you understand it. Two different windows will be open on your computer. You'll have one window open to your bulletin, the other window open to the worship so that you can share that experience with us. And again, if you're unable to make that happen, or if you'd like to comment on it or like help getting it set up for next week, please let us know during the week. The other change is that a number of our worship elements are sent into us remotely by folks you'll recognize from our church family, so that at times you'll be seeing something that's taking place here in the sanctuary, and at other times you're going to see a different background, a different face, hear a different voice. We hope that's not disorienting, but we'd love to hear from you. It's remarkable to watch the ways that our family has responded to the circumstances in which we live and made sure that we would continue to be able to gather together and continue to be able to worship the Lord our God. So I'm going to invite you, whether you're here or at home, to sing together as we sing the praises of our God.
Those that are in the sanctuary, Lord, wherever we are, you know that we're together with you. You've been with us throughout all these separations. Lord Jesus, I thank you for the healing that you've given us, the protection. I thank you for the spirit of no fear, the spirit of togetherness, the spirit of how can we help others. Lord Jesus, I ask you to come today and be with us as we worship you, as we sing your songs and hear your prayers and listen to your word. Lord, we just thank you for the goodness and the mercy that you give us each and every day. We ask you to help us to be that kind of a person to others. Amen.
Yeah.
Please join me in the reading, responsive reading from the Psalm 42. As a deer longs for flowing streams, so longs my soul for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and behold the face of God? My tears have been my food day and night, while people say to me continually, "Where is your God?" These things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I went with the throng and led them in procession to the house of God, with glad shouts and songs of thanksgiving, a multitude keeping festival. Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, whom again I shall praise, my help and my God. My soul is cast down within me. Therefore I remember you from the land of Jordan and of Hermon, from Mount Mizar. Deep calls to deep, all gone under cataracts. All your waves and your billows have gone before me. By day the Lord commands his steadfast love, and at night God's song is with me, a prayer to the God of my life. I seek God. Why have you forgotten me? Why do I mourn because of the oppression of the enemy? Like a deadly wound in my body, my adversaries taunt me. They say to me continually, "Where is your God?" Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, whom again I shall praise, my help and my God. Amen.
Good morning. The scripture reading this morning is from the book of Romans, chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. I ask then, did God reject his people? By no means. I am an Israelite myself, a descendant of Abraham from the tribe of Benjamin. God did not reject his people whom he foreknew. Don't you know what scripture says in the passage about Elijah? How he appealed to God against Israel? Lord, they have killed your prophets and torn down your altars. I am the only one left, and they are trying to kill me. And what was God's answer to him? I have reserved for myself 7,000 who have not bowed the knee to Baal. So too, at the present time, there is a remnant chosen by grace. And if by grace, then it cannot be based on works. If it were, grace would no longer be grace. What then? What the people of Israel sought so earnestly, they did not obtain. The elect among them did, but the others were hardened. As it is written, God gave them a spirit of stupor, eyes that could not see and ears that could not hear, to this very day. And David says, may their table become a snare and a trap, a stumbling block and a retribution for them. May their eyes be darkened so they cannot see and their backs be bent forever. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. I hope you are all doing well. I am here at home right now, staying in place, doing my best to stay healthy and to keep others healthy as well. But I am very happy that I can join you this morning in a special video children's message. I was reading our scripture passages for this morning. In particular, Psalm 42 really struck me. It was very beautiful. It was very poetic. I do love that opening lines about as the deer pants for the water. And it made me think about when it talks about, you know, where is God? Where is God in all of this? And it reminded me how a few weeks ago there was a children's message that I did. It was probably way back in February when there was still snow on the ground. And I remember asking the kids, you know, is winter ever going to end? Are we ever going to get away from the snow? Are we ever going to get out of the cold? And the answer, of course, is yes, absolutely. And so I stepped outside this morning, a little cautious at first because the temperature on my phone told me it was going to be in the 30s. but it was much nicer when I did step outside. So instead of putting on my winter coat, I put on my purple fleece, and I was immediately struck by this smell of spring. That might sound strange, but I could smell the moisture in the air. I could smell the new plants and the new grass coming up, and you can hear the birds all around us. And there's just this promise of new life, this promise of spring. And you can see it as well. I don't know, I'm gonna try and see if I can show this here. Turn my phone around. But there's the daylilies. They're starting to sprout. And then walking over here. And the trees, they're starting to bud. So, yeah, the signs of new life, the signs of spring are all around us. It reminds us that no matter how cold and how fierce the winters get, spring will always come back. Spring will always return. And that reminds us also, I think, that we can remember God is always with us too. When we go through hard times, we sometimes wonder, where is God in all this? But God never leaves us. God is there. There are so many examples and stories in the Bible, from the Hebrews being slaves in Egypt to when they were exiled from their homeland by the Babylonians. And then certainly when the disciples were wondering after Jesus was arrested, where is God? God never abandoned them. God was with them. And God always brings the wonders of freedom and homecoming and Easter back to us. So we have hope in that. We can remember that God does not abandon. God is there. God is present. And God asks us to be present too. So I know right now many of us are feeling a little anxious. Some of us might be feeling a little bored. Some of us may be wondering, when is life going to go back to normal? But I think it's important to remember that God is with us. And through all those tough times, all the tough times in our past and the tough times that are still to come, God loves us and is by our side that whole time. So we need to put our trust and our faith in God and provide that trust, faith, and hope for others as well. Show them the love of Jesus in all that we do and say. Keep those connections strong. And especially remember that not to take things for granted and to find blessing in all that we do. So let that be our hope and our prayer for this day, and let us be a hope for others as well. So let's end our time right now with a prayer, shall we? Okay. Holy God, we thank you so much for the beauty of nature, for the return of spring and the promise of new life. We're feeling a little uncertain, Lord, but we are reminded through the scriptures that you are with us, that you have never abandoned us, and that throughout the tough times in life, you will be with us always. So help us to put our faith, our hope, and our trust in you, and help us to be, as Christ calls us to be, a blessing for others as well, to mirror him in all that we do, in love and in hope. So thank you, God, for this beautiful day, and thank you, God, for the promise that you bring of a resurrection that is coming. Amen. All right, so thank you so much for joining me this morning, and I hope that you all stay safe. Do what you can to stay healthy, please. Wash your hands, obviously, and certainly reach out and help others when you are able. And keep those connections strong. Call people, write to them, whether you reach across from a computer screen or whether it's picking up a phone, but keep those connections strong and help everyone know that we love you just as much as God loves you. All right, thanks everybody. Bye-bye.
Attendeth my way when sorrow. morning. I'd like to read to you an excerpt from the book, A Guide to Prayer for Ministers and Other Servants. This particular excerpt is written from Prayers for the Christian Church by William Barclay. Hear these words. O God, our Father, we know that the issues of life and death are in your hands, and we know that you are loving us in an everlasting love. If it is your will, grant to us to live in happiness and in peace. In all our undertakings, grant us prosperity and good success. In all our friendships, grant us to find our friends faithful and true. In all bodily things, make us fit and healthy, able for the work of the day. In all the things of the mind, make us calm and serene, free from anxiety and worry. In material things, save us from poverty and from want. In spiritual things, save us from doubt and from distrust. Grant us, in our work, satisfaction. In our study, true wisdom. In our pleasure, gladness. In our love, loyalty. And if misfortune does come to us, grant that any trial may only bring us closer to one another and closer to you. And grant that nothing may shake our certainty that you work all things together for your good, and that a father's hand will never cause his child a needless tear. Let us now pray for the concerns of our church and of our world. Gracious and loving God, we come to you together from afar, but yet united as the body in Christ. We praise you and thank you, God, for how you have just given us all that we are and all that we need in this past week. You provided for us food, family, shelter, comfort, and love. We thank you, Lord, for how we have been celebrating. Even as we cannot touch one another physically, we are celebrating with one another through a variety of means. We celebrate birthdays that have been happening and anniversaries. We celebrate new babies and new grandbabies. We celebrate other special things happening in our lives, and we give you thanks for that. We celebrate healings that have been happening, homecomings that are occurring, people coming home at unexpected times. We give you thanks, Lord, for these. But Lord, we also acknowledge that in these times of celebration, we also have times of concern and anxiety, fear and grief, and loss. And so we surrender these to you as well, Lord, lifting them up to you silently and verbally. So we lift to you from our church family now the following people: Gary Turner, Ken Terranoni, Mary Tillema, Bev Hirsch, Ron Ramos, and for their particular concerns that are current and ongoing. We lift up to you also those that are in nursing homes or assisted living or are shut in at home. Myrtle Hermanson, Don Strait, Pete Gustafson, Bev Coppin, Marjorie Keegan, Bob Clare, Joanne Emery, Donna Van Fleet, Linda Wilkinson, Ruby Hendrickson. May we continue to be the hands and feet of Christ. May we continue to reach out to these people, letting them know that we are so very connected to them, even if we cannot physically see them. We pray, Lord, for the families and friends of our congregation, for those who are struggling with cancer concerns, for those who are struggling with physical pain and financial distress, for those who are far away in foreign countries, for those who are needing healing from head traumas. We pray, Lord, for those who are homeless and are needing a place to stay and food to eat. We pray for children who are experiencing traumatic events now and are not in school where they might be safe. We pray for those, Lord, who are struggling with addictions. And we pray for any who might be struggling to feed their families. We also pray, Lord, for the COVID-19 issues that are affecting every one of us in some way. We know, Lord, that you are not a stranger to what is happening and that you can take all of this and fashion it to your glory. And we pray for what society will look like when this is all done. We pray that we might be strengthened and renewed and see your new creation on the other side. And so, For all of this, Lord, we surrender our prayers. And we end this time of praise, prayer, and petition to you, God, with the words that Jesus has given us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who've trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, forever and ever. Amen.
Well, as we began this section of the book of Romans weeks ago, the beginnings of chapters 9, 10, and 11, Dave Meyer was preaching. And Dave said to us on that Sunday morning that this text and this section of the Bible were a heart check for us. And I announced to you this morning, ladies and gentlemen, there is a prophet among us. I don't think Dave had any idea when he uttered those words what we would be facing before we finish chapter 11 of the book of Romans. I think he was being faithful to the text that he was preaching. Paul described his motivation, even his willingness to sacrifice, so that his people could know the goodness of God in the land of the living. And as I listened at first to the video replay of that message, and then I chose to mention that the next week just so that I could build on that foundation Dave had laid, I had no idea what we would be facing. And each week since, it has seemed applicable, and it has been more and more obvious that the Holy Spirit of God has been moving through the scripture texts and lining up the Word of God with the things we need to hear. Lent is for us a time of a heart check. Are our hearts right? And a pandemic is for us a time of a heart check. Do we depend on the right things, participate in the right things? And now we even have more time for reflection. Now, we said during this section, chapters 9, 10, and 11, that we're looking at the relationship between the Jewish people and Gentile people, kind of race relations in the first century. And we've reminded ourselves that today, literally, I can see the ones in the room. I'm pretty sure every one of us is a Gentile Christian. Don't know entirely who's there on the internet watching us, but I'm going to say we're all Gentile Christians this morning, but yet spiritually we're more like the nation of Israel was in Paul's day. We're the ones who were born into one nation under God, who are heirs to the promises of God, and we've kind of associated our culture, our customs and practices, our nation and people with our religious faith. And in some ways, the lines are blurred. We have a hard time telling them apart. So now, sometimes, we look at a different culture, other customs and practices, nations and peoples, as if maybe God doesn't bless them. We dismiss and even judge them. It's a heart check for us to consider, how do we relate to God and how do we relate to all the people we come in contact with. Now, last week, Paul was talking about the problem that was facing the church in Rome and the people of Israel, and the problem was not a lack of preaching the word. That's an important thing, Paul said. The problem was a lack of response to the word that was preached. Paul described it as the good news of goodness. Kind of a hard phrase to translate, so I was using gospel of grace. The good news that God's power are actively at work changing things in the world today. Or as we learned earlier, that in all things, even pandemics, God is at work for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. So we're back to that root question again. Do you love him? Do we love him? It's the main question, maybe the only question. Will you pray with me as we begin to look into God's word? Lord, increase our faith, yes. In the light of everything that we face, may we be able to respond well. More than that, increase our love. Lord, even if I don't respond well, help me to love you with all my heart and soul and strength, and then to trust you and your power at work in the world. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, Paul starts this passage with a kind of a rhetorical question, and then the answer, he says, has God rejected, abandoned God's people, the people of Israel? Then he immediately responds, by no means. God forbid. It's a tough phrase to translate. We've heard it before in Romans. We've talked about it before. You'll remember back in chapter 6, the question was, if a righteousness of works, of following the law, has been replaced by a righteousness of faith, does that mean that we just go out and sin boldly? By no means. And then in chapter 7, Paul was saying, now, if the death of Jesus Christ on the cross has become our means to God's grace and no longer the keeping of the law and the sacrifices and everything, then has the law become death to me? And again, Paul says, by no means. Now, those two questions may have been things that they were asking in the Roman church. Probably not. They may have been things that were reported. Hey, Paul's preaching this out there in the world. They might have even been gossiping about him. You know, I heard Paul was preaching this, and he's trying to defend himself and correct them. But this question is not some hypothetical or theological. It's an existential question for the church in Rome and for Paul. Has God rejected us? And as Dave pointed out, beginning this section, what's at stake is that if God would reject the people of Israel with whom God made binding covenants, then we stand here waiting for the other shoe to drop. God may reject us at any day. Has God rejected his people? By no means. And the good news is that God, way back making those covenants before we were called Israel or Jews, God was not deluded into thinking that all of us would be faithful all the time throughout all time. God knew before God ever made the covenant that maybe most of us would backslide, fall short, get distracted, and God made the covenant anyway. And that means that there was never a morning when God woke up and said, OMG, what has happened? God never said, oh, it's gone too far now and we've got to cut this thing off. Because God was prepared all along for what God experienced, what we now experience in time. God already had the remedy. God already had it factored into God's covenant. And that's important to us because we know that if God has not rejected, abandoned Israel, then God has not rejected or abandoned you or me, or the United States of America, or Belvidere First United Methodist Church. When God makes a covenant, it stands. When God makes a promise, it stands. And God has not rejected Israel. It's like what Paul said back in the fifth chapter. God demonstrates God's love for us in this, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. If this is how God treats enemies, think how much more God is going to take care of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. Today, Paul refers back to the Old Testament to give an example, an illustration. He says, do you remember the prophet Elijah? Show of virtual hands. Does everybody remember the prophet Elijah? There was a showdown up on Mount Carmel. The people of God were just in some of their worst days. They had really abandoned following God, and they had really taken up the popular religion of the day, worshiping this Baal, this fertility god. And so Elijah gets tired of it, and he challenges the church of Baal. Okay, guys, show down in the stadium. Let's go up the mountainside, and let's see whose God really is God. And the showdown took all day, and Elijah prevailed. God prevailed and demonstrated that Baal was a fraud and God was real. The people said, that's it. We're going to kick all of this Baal God out of our place, and we're going to go back to the Lord God Almighty. And at the end of the day, instead of celebrating, Elijah was suicidal. He went out and he prayed, God, just take me out right now. Because you saw the mountainside. I'm the only one left. The only one left who's faithful to you. And now, there's a price on my head. And as they say, he wasn't paranoid. They really were conspiring against him. And then God whispered in his ear, son, you may not be able to see it, but I have preserved for myself a remnant. 7,000 people you may not know about, but I do, who love me with all their heart, with all their soul, and with all their strength. So quit your whining. We've got work to do. A remnant. What an idea. It fits. If God knew that we wouldn't all be faithful all the time throughout eternity, then God factored in the idea that there'd be some disobedience and some distraction, and then God was prepared to work with and through the ones who are faithful. So back in the Old Testament, in another one of Israel's worst days, we were captured and conquered, and we were under oppression. And God raised up a man named Gideon to deliver us. Gideon was just a guy, and God showed up and said, I'd like you to lead my people to freedom. You're going to have to win a big battle. So Gideon called out all the troops, except there were no troops. So he ended up with 10,000 farmers with clubs and pitchforks. No weapons, no armor. But 10,000 guys was pretty impressive, and the only problem was they were facing 100,000 with armor and shields and swords and some horses. It was a mismatch. And God looked at this army of 10,000 farmers, and he said, too many. And God said, I'll tell you what we'll do. Let's narrow them down. Took it down to 300, and instead of their pitchforks and clubs, God gave them torches and trumpets. Throughout the time of God's people, torches, lanterns, lamps have stood for God's word, and trumpets have stood for the proclamation, the messenger. God said, with 300 people armed only with God's word and the willingness to witness, I'm going to conquer the enemy. God has always had a plan that factors in a remnant, and there's good news in that, and there's bad news in that. God has already prepared for the times when we would not be there, when we would be distracted by something else, when we wouldn't be part of the force. God is perfectly prepared to work through the ones who are present. And the downside of that is that God is prepared to work without the ones who are not with the program. So Jesus tells parables. I had to cut down the list, but a couple that stood out to me. He tells parables about the kingdom of God, which will be established at the end of time. He tells about a wedding feast that will be held. He talks about 10 bridesmaids who are going to be the bridal party. Just think about the symbolic significance. If the church is the bride of Christ, then these are the 10 who are going to attend the church as she enters into the joy of her master. And they went and they got ready, and some of them prepared and provisioned. And when the time came, they were ready to go. And some of them got distracted by other things and tired, and they left off their preparation. And God was prepared to work with a smaller bridal party of the ones who were prepared and ready. That's sort of the good news side of it. It's one of the more optimistic parables in that half of the people make it to the wedding. Jesus tells another parable about sowing seed in a field as the kingdom that would come. And the enemy came and sowed bad seed in the midst of the good seed, and it came up all together, weeds and wheat. And the servants wanted to know, what do we do with a field like this? Should we burn the whole thing? Should we pick it out? And God said, no. I'll tell you what, all this year I'll have the ugliest field in the township. And when the harvest comes, then we'll sort the things out and we'll keep the wheat. This idea of a remnant is the idea that God watches over all those who are part of God's people and is prepared to work with some fraction. the message to Elijah was, I have preserved for myself 7,000. And that word preserved does not mean that God has looked over all of God's people and has been really, really mean to some so that they would go away, and has been really, really nice to others so that they would stay near. Or that God has with a magic wand zapped some so that I shouldn't be pointing at you when I'm doing the zap thing, right? So anyway, zapped some so that they would, so that they would go away, and has zapped others so that they would stay. It's that God has looked out over millions and seen 7,000, known who they were, protected them from persecution, preserved them in times of difficulty, in some cases introduced them to each other so that they could encourage each other and be stronger together, build up and bring more in, and in other cases has separated them so that they wouldn't be implicated when they were found out. And God has watched over, has worked for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purposes. 7,000 who haven't bowed the knee to Baal. And my sense is, looking around the room, I have a pretty high degree of confidence nobody here has bowed the knee to Baal. And imagining who might be watching, I sort of can give assurance that that's not true of any of us. But it does kind of raise the question, what would that look like today? They at one time were God's people, they at one time were obedient and worshipful, and now they were worshiping other things and engaging in other culture, customs, and practices. What happened? Something else became more desirable. Something else became more popular. Some friend invited them to something that they had no business involving themselves in. For a variety of reasons, all understandable, they ended up going a different direction. And that happens today. That, you know, we start well, certain that we're part of the people of God, and gradually that becomes a lower priority, and we lean on other things for our sense of well-being. We desire other things, use our money and free time on other things. And Paul concludes the matter by saying in his time that what they had so earnestly desired, pursued, they did not lay hold of, while other people who had not with the same earnest effort pursued the thing, did lay hold of it. I tell every church that I'm assigned to pastor, you get the church that you want and work for. That's not an individual promise. Nobody gets the church they want and work for unless they want a church of only one person. But as a family, we pretty much get the church that we want and work for. As a family, we don't get the church we want, because all of us have desires and ideas, but the things that we pursue and act on, pretty much we get those things. And Paul is describing about the people of Israel that they'd started off as God's people. What they wanted was God's favor, and the way to do that was to obey the law, and so that was their means to God's favor. There was a certain culture and customs and practices that they associated with getting God's favor, and so they doubled down on these things. They believed that by keeping the Sabbath and eating a kosher diet and a variety of things like that, that they would live forever in God's. And it got to the point where they wanted the law and the system and the culture, and it even snuck up on them. They felt superior because they were the Sabbath-observant, kosher-keeping people of God. And they figured other people not so much. And Paul is saying the funny thing is that people who did not give a hoot about the Sabbath or about kosher, one by one realized that they needed God's mercy, that they depended on God's grace. And they inherited God's mercy and grace, and Israel had the Sabbath and kosher. And the thing that they had pursued, the favor of God, well, they didn't lay hold of that. It's a heart check for us to ask, what are the things that we are earnestly desiring and pursuing? And it comes at a perfect time, Lent in the religious calendar, pandemic in the world around us, the sort of abrupt interruption of a lot of the things that we've been doing with our time and money and perhaps our desire and effort. And we find ourselves in this position of asking, have we bought into a secular perspective on what we desire? We want prosperity, we want health, we want community. And always we have believed that these are God's will for us, that as we lived as God's people, we would prosper and be healthy and have community beyond the norm. And have we started to pursue them as ends in themselves rather than as gifts of God to be enjoyed and celebrated? And as we all, to different degrees, distance ourselves and shelter in place, we're left kind of reassessing. What will we participate in? What will we seek after? I think in many ways, there's a reset button going on in America. There are many of the things that have been interrupted that when the all clear is sounded, I think we're just going to go right back full speed ahead. And I think there are other things that we've been involved in that when the reset button is pushed, when the all clear is sounded, that we won't return to. I was driving home from church last Sunday and I turned on the radio and there was a basketball game on. I thought, a basketball game. It's been a long time since I could listen to a basketball game. It was a really exciting game. At some point, I heard the word Gonzaga. I know Gonzaga. That's an American unit. Wait a minute. They're not supposed to be playing. What's going on here? Gradually, it became clear that the star of the game was a guy named Steph Curry. So the game must have been played 10 years ago or something like that. A radio station was smart enough to figure that Americans were missing their March Madness, and they gave us a little bit. But I got to tell you, all the way home, and I had a good idea how the game went. Man, that was exciting. And I'm just thinking, are we going to wake up in 2 or 3 months realizing we have an archive of the most exciting sports highlights? We could go years before we needed another live game. And in some cases, it's cheaper and more accessible on demand. Who needs those high-paid ads? Well, look, I wouldn't wish that on America. But you get the idea. As we interrupt many of our entertainment functions and many of the places that we group and gather, some of them will be restored in full, and some of them may never come back. We're left wondering, what are the things that we'll spend our time and money, our desire and energy on? We're left with the opportunity to tune in again to the favor of God directly instead of something that we have associated with the favor of God and has become Baal in our life. If you read the emails and Facebook posts that we're sending out each week, you read this week, it's a great opportunity, as Deacon Sharon was talking about, for us to be the family of the church. I want to encourage everybody in the room, over the stream, even everybody who looks back on it, figure out what's your primary connection with this place, especially if you're not here on Sunday morning. What after Sunday morning worship is your primary connection with God's people in this place, and keep that connection alive. Just resolve by whatever means, phone calls, emails, Facebook groups, whether it's your ministry team, your committee assignment, an activity group, just line up your closest friends and don't just check on each other, but pray for each other. Offer a devotion that's been meaningful to you. Listen to one that's been meaningful to them. In some ways, we'll be more church as we attend to being close because we are church family than we were when we were pursuing other things. In the end, when the all clear is sounded, it's entirely possible if for weeks we've been practicing keeping in touch with each other on a regular basis throughout the week, it may be that we, First United Methodist Church, emerge a little bit stronger, a little bit more nimble because we're in closer contact with each other, a little bit more ready to move ahead. It would be real easy in times like these to ask, has God abandoned me? Has God abandoned the United States or First United Methodist Church? Even the whole world, which God created. And important for us to hear Paul's word. No, by no means. God forbid, that will never happen as long as time passes. And it would be real easy, particularly for those of you who are sitting at home, to say, this is enough. This is not the meaning of life to me. You might as well take me out right now, Lord, because I'm alone. And I'm looking at things going on around me that I don't like, and I'm not connected to the things that I believe in and do like. And so for us this morning to hear God's voice saying, my child, you may not be able to see them right now, but I'm watching over a faithful remnant that love me with all their heart and soul and strength. And not only in a time of pandemic, but in every time that you will ever face or could ever imagine, I'm going to be at work for the good of those who love me and are called according to my purposes. And while we shelter in place and slow down the pace of life just a little bit, we can ask ourselves again and again, more than anything else, do I love him? More than anything else, do I rely on his goodness in my life? I'm going to invite the praise team to come up to just remind us, the one who has promised to be ours, has promised to watch over us for good, is the Lord God Almighty, sovereign over everything that is, whether we've seen it or not. And we can sing the greatness of our God and rely on his goodness in the land of the living.
Age to age he stands, and time.
Amen. And that greatness is not affected by the balance in my checkbook, the circumstances around us, the limitations we face. It is unending and unlimited. Hey, next week when we gather together, it's going to be the 5th of April. In answer to Deacon Sharon's question, when does spring come? I believe it was day before yesterday or something like that. When just for a minute it was pretty. Spring has come and gone. I expect autumn along shortly, but April will be here this week. And two things about next Sunday. Sunday the 5th of April will be Palm Sunday and will be Communion Sunday. So we're going to invite you to tune in by the live stream next week, just as we have this week. But as we close up at 10 o'clock, and the preacher has been practicing restraint so that we can be sure to be done before 10 o'clock, we want to invite you next week to come by and receive communion and receive palms. And at first sound, that might seem incredible. What our intent is to be a drive-through like any other drive-through. We're going to enter from the south end of the parking lot and make our way around the parking lot, come up alongside the door of the church with your driver's side against the curb. During the worship service next week, we're going to have our prayer of thanksgiving and communion here, and you'll see individual packets of communion right here on the communion table being blessed. And then by 10 o'clock sharp, unless the preacher misbehaves, we will make our way out to the exit door. And with a gloved hand, you'll receive a piece of communion that, to best of my knowledge, has never been touched by human hand. And then a car length later on, as you pull across, you're going to receive a palm branch. And if we get really crazy, bunches of us might drive together through town, honking our horns and waving our palms and declaring the greatness of our God here in the community of Belvidere. It may be that you have one of them fancy portable devices that has a computer in it, and you could sit in our parking lot and watch the worship service on your device just more than 6 feet away and be first in line for communion. We are going to invite particularly our first responders, emergency and essential personnel, and we'll have an express lane for them so that they don't have to wait in the massive line of Belvidereans who will want to receive communion to know that they're still in touch with our God. So please make sure that you're in contact with our family throughout the week. Make sure that they're aware of this opportunity. We do not wish to lure anybody out of the safety of their home, but we do wish to provide the sacrament of communion to all those who would choose to come here and receive it in the most responsible and safe way possible. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him so that you, this week under pandemic, may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit and light up your world. Go in peace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and remain with us always. Amen.
Amen.
Then sings my soul.